Good day, folks. I'd like to talk to you about over-unity and how it's widely misunderstood by the generic scientific community, and I'd like to explain why. Basically, I get very frustrated when the first thing they do is accuse me and us of flat-out breaking the rules of thermodynamics. They basically tell us that, you know, energy can be created out of nothing, and you can't take energy, basically an input electricity energy, and get more output from it, from the same system. You can't do that. So basically, they say, well, over unity, it's out of the question, don't even look into it, you're just digging yourself a rabbit hole, it's not going to work, science debunked this a long time ago, end of discussion, let's not even look into it. This is a very bad way of looking at it, and this is why, because what they don't seem to understand, even though it is true what they say, they look at it in a single energy system. Let me give you an example. You've got your battery here. So here's your plus and here's your minus. This is how they look at it. This is a form of electrical energy. So we're dealing with one form of energy. The plus goes here. It'll light up our LED. And it goes like this and it loops back into the minus of the battery, okay? And this is the flow that we get. It's a closed loop system, meaning that when it's going to come back, there's going to be less than what we put in, and there's no way around that. Yes, they are correct, but this is what they don't understand, is when we're building over unity systems, we don't just play with one kind of energy. We introduce multiple sources in the system, and by doing that, we're not breaking any rules of thermodynamic whatsoever. And Tom Bearden sort of had a point with this, and he tried to explain it, but he seemed to have a way to complicate things, and he had some sort of diagram with units and parts, and he was dividing all that and making it very complicated, and there's just, I don't know why he did that, because, you know, I really respect him for some of his theories, but the way they all explain things, it seems like sometimes they wanted to mislead more than lead people in the right direction. So this is how I'm going to try and simplify it here. So you have, basically, we're going to use, we want to create, what we're interested in is electrical energy net gains. So, as I said, you can't create energy out of nothing, so we're going to have to provide a trigger. So I've already discussed various ways of providing very low voltage triggers, to a point that depending on the configuration you want to use, you may not even have to really pay for that input trigger because we're depending on other systems. So I'll show you a block diagram of this. So here's our input trigger, right here. This is the input, right here. So we're going to say that this is going to be 10 volts and it's going to pulse 25 milliamps at 1% duty cycle, okay? That's our input trigger. We're going to have to pay for that somehow, but like I discussed earlier, we have several mechanisms that we can use, so we don't really, I mean, if you're lucky enough to live by a river, it could be as traditional as a hydro wheel, you know, there you go. But some people may not be as lucky, so they may need to get more creative, but I have outlined several possibilities. So you have your trigger, 25 milliamp, that's electrical energy input. But now we have a system here we're introducing. By pulsing it, we've got another system, which is the magnetic. So I'm going to put M for magnetic. And you've got the resonance. So that's another system. So now, when you trigger these systems on their own, which can't do anything because they need the trigger, but you provide the trigger, this creates another system of energies here that are manipulatable. We increase the amplitude, we use feedback and various methods, we introduce, and it's not breaking the laws of thermodynamics, folks, because we're not taking something out of nothing, we're providing a trigger, we're creating a reaction, we're manipulating external energy systems, and there's no specific rule that tells you how many you could incorporate in the system. If you can find out ways to do it with multiple systems, all the power to you, literally. So here's a simple concept that uses, so when you pulse, for example, you kill the power here and it creates a new field with the back EMF. So at every event, you're creating a new source of energy into the system, your wood resonance and amplification, your through that system, and then we're finding a way to induce it back into an electrical form. So that's your inducer here. Another system which transduces this back into an electrical form of energy that we're looking for. Now all of a sudden the output comes out at 20 volts, 100 milliamps, because of the interaction with the various systems that would be at play that we wouldn't have normally been able to tap into, but because of clever mechanisms such as the systems I've described in other videos, we're able to do this. Now, some people would even consider another type of system. I'm talking about what's already well proven that we can do, okay? But some people will argue that, you know, you've got the quantum physics, Tom Bearden's vacuum energy, for example. This is basically unproven theory, so I can't say this is real, but according to quantum physics, it's a great possibility. But at the end of the day, it's unproven science, so I have to specify that. But let's say that's up to you. If you feel that, you know, that technology for you works and you've made your own personal advancements, then optionally you can consider another energy input here, and that would be the vacuum. So if you incorporate the vacuum methods of Tom Bearden and Bedini, that would be another potential system that you can use to get a greater net output gain. But again, the vacuum energy, I can personally say it'll work, but I also have to be honest and say I've explored with it myself, and I have some videos that demonstrate some of the concepts that seem to show promising results, but however, science is not quite there yet, so it's better to stick in the scientific community with concepts that are already well proven, and we can do that with concepts we already know. And the key is just to use multiple energy systems together. We could use chemistry, we could use different reactions and different energy systems into one system. So this is where Tom Bearden was talking about, you know, here's one part you're putting in, but all of a sudden you got another part here and another part here, and that equals, you know, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, so that's 5 parts at the end, and there comes your effect without breaking any laws of physics. And that's not even considering the vacuum energy here. This is totally optional because we can't prove that. But we can use existing systems to get over unity today. That's an electrical energy form. We have to consider using multiple systems because this won't work as a single. And unfortunately, the rule, as you learn it in school, it's kind of written in a way where it shuts your mind off from the start of even thinking of systems like this to advance. Imagine if the high school students with the minds are fresh and this is what they are learned in science, they would come up with the technologies to better advance this and come up with the ideas, but we're not showing them this, and instead we're misleading them with a statement that's only half true, in the sense that it's the closed loop, if it's only dealing with one form of electricity, that specific form, that's where it's true, but they should specify that it's only for one system, and we could indeed introduce multiple systems, and if we have a clever mechanism, this is where we get our net gain in electrical energy here. So some people have commented that, you know, I've been doing a lot of theory lately, and theory is nice, it's all talk, and they want some demonstrations. So I'm going to show you a simple demonstration of how we could use a trigger voltage with the human body. And for some reason, if I would have saw this in science class in high school when my mind was fresh, I'm telling you, by today I would have come up with something that's absolutely great and fantastic. So I really regret that we don't show this in high school, and this is a simple demonstration that could be shown, and I'm going to show you right now how you could use the human body as a trigger voltage. We're going to convert, in this example, my body into an ion-based cell. So how to do that? I've got the voltmeter here. I've got a piece of magnesium on the lead clip. This is one type of metal. And we have the positive side here, which this is a different kind of metal here. So what's going to happen is when I touch this with one hand and touch this with the other hand, that's going to be the two different metals, and my body is going to act as the electrolyte material, and we're going to have a voltage on the meter of about 1.7 volts,
And this is going to give us a low current of about 25 milliamps. Now that's more than enough to light up a LED, a LED. You could run even small oscillators, flyback circuits, and this is where I introduce on one of my other videos how this could be adapted into a wearable technology, because you're creating a magnetic field around your body, which could potentially be used as a sort of back EMF feedback loop with wearable technology. And that could be the body could be this low voltage trigger to produce a feedback mechanism, which would be a wireless charger for your phones in your pocket and your tablet, whatnot. So let me show you how this trigger works. I'm just going to put the voltmeter here on DC on 20 volts. You'll see here it's zero, so I'm grabbing the magnesium sheet here real tight with my hand. So I'm going to hold the meter down here so you can see it here. And I'm going to grab, and what's going to happen, you see the meter? Now we're at like 1. It's hard to see from this side here, but it's over 1 volt, that's for sure. As you can see, close to 1.6. So when I stop holding the wire here, no more. So basically my body is acting as the electrolyte material between an ion-based battery between two dissimilar metals, and you get a voltage. And 25 milliwatts at close to 2 volts, folks, that could be used as a pretty interesting trigger for some circuits and projects. And if somebody would have shown me this in science class in grade 9 in high school, I would have opened up my mind to all kinds of potentials of great technologies out there that we probably don't have, along with everybody else who would have saw this demonstration. So anyways, I hope you enjoy. More food for thought. And have a good day, and let me know what you all think. Thank you. Have a good day, all.